Today on the Nick DeLeon Show.
More than 2 weeks ago, a 21-year-old named Dylann Roof has killed nine people at the Emanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church on Wednesday, June 17th. On June 26th, the landmark case of Obergefell versus Hodges has been voted 5-4 in the U.S. Supreme Court, and now same-sex couples are officially allowed to wed in all 50 states. On July 5th, the United States women's soccer team has won 5-2 against Japan in the FIFA Women's World Cup at BC Play Stadium in Vancouver, Canada.
Hey, this is the Nick DeLeon Show. We have all kinds of stuff to discuss on today's program. Don't you even think about clicking that mouse anywhere else, so stay tuned.
Racism, same-sex marriage, and President Obama using the N-word on a radio program are what is part of what makes up our news today. More than 2 weeks ago, a 21-year-old named Dylann Roof has killed nine people at the Emanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church on Wednesday, June 17th, including former South Carolina State Senator Reverend Clementa Pinckney, who died at 41 years old. A tenth person was shot at the church but survived the gunshot wounds. The United States Department of Justice is investigating the possibility that the shooting was either a hate crime or an act of domestic terrorism, among other motives. Roof has been charged for nine counts of murder in the state of South Carolina, one being a first degree. If convicted, Roof could face either 30 to life in prison or the death penalty. In relevant news, a national debate about the South Carolina government flying the Confederate flag on state grounds has been highly controversial following the Charleston shooting. Many politicians, including Republicans, such as former 2012 presidential nominee Mitt Romney, have been agreeing that the flag should not be flown on public grounds, such as government offices, and should be kept in museums. Major retailers such as Walmart, Amazon.com, eBay, Sears, which also operates Kmart and Target, and Google have made bans. So why the f*** isn't its sale of Confederate bandanas such a problem for Hobby Lobby? I don't know! Now for some happier news. On June 26th, the landmark case of Obergefell versus Hodges has been voted 5-4 in the U.S. Supreme Court, and now same-sex couples are officially allowed to wed in all 50 states. No longer may this liberty be denied, said Justice Anthony Kennedy. The vote was a narrow 5-4, but Kennedy's majority opinion was clear and firm. The court now holds that same-sex couples may exercise the fundamental right to marry. The ruling will put an end to same-sex marriage bans in the 14 states that will maintain them, and provide an exclamation point for breathtaking changes in the nation's social norms in recent years. As recently as last year, just over one-third of the states permitted same-sex marriage. Kennedy's reading of the ruling elicited tears in the courtroom. Euphoria outside of the immediate issuance of marriage licenses to same-sex couples in the last eight states. In Dallas, Kenneth Denson said he and Gabriel Mendez has been legally married since 2013 in California. But we're Texans. We want to get married in Texas. In praise of the decision, President Barack Obama called it justice that arrives just like a thunderbolt. Kennedy said nothing in the court's ruling that would force religions to condone, much less perform weddings and such any object, and he said couples seeking the right to marry should not have to wait for the political branches of government to act. The 14th Amendment of the Constitution requires that states allow same-sex couples to marry on the same basis as heterosexuals, he said. The dynamic of our constitutional system is that individuals need to not wait legislative action before asserting a fundamental right. The nation's courts are open to injured individuals who come from them to vindicate their own direct, personal stake in our basic charter, Kennedy wrote in his fourth major opinion in support of gay rights since 1996. It came on the anniversary of two of those earlier decisions. No union is more profound than marriage, Kennedy wrote, joined by the court's four more liberal justices.
Now time for our commercial break.
Let me drive for a little bit.
20 minutes behind the wheel.
Yay!
Well, Sam, it's been 20 minutes. You want to take over?
Ted, you want to be human in the eyes of the law. That's a hard sell.
You two gotta get educated. Can either of you tell me who wrote The Great Gatsby?
Judy Blume? Hitler?
F. Scott Fitzgerald.
What did Scott Fitzgerald do to you?
Yeah.
What?
You just said F. Scott Fitzgerald.
You guys are idiots.
Ted 2.
Don't squirt your jorts. F***ed up news is on your way. When a man in a giant penis costume ejaculates confetti on people, you pay attention. But are you thinking about practicing safe sex? That's the dilemma facing a wacky PSA in Norway to combat the increase of STDs there. Penises can surprise you, says the tagline in Norwegian. A spokesperson for the Involve agency behind the spot told Mirror the commercial that is intended to highlight the fun and naughtiness of sex, though admittedly many over 30 thought the campaign was pointless, and some went so far to brand it as idiotic. Silly as it is, the video aims to use a condom message at 16 to 25-year-olds, The Telegraph reported. This is a group that is not swayed by lecturing, facts, or scaremongering, RSFU's Christina Plack said. The guy wearing the getup is 19-year-old student Philip Van Eck, reportedly told Norwegian outlet that he's happy to do his part. I thought it was hilarious. I thought it can help others just by being a d***. There's nothing better. First there was interracial marriage, then there was same-sex marriage, and now there's robot marriage? In a ceremony that confirmed the worst fears of anti-gay marriage advocate the world over, two robots were wed in Japan over the weekend, according to The Telegraph. Froyce, the bulky groom that made partially from a trash can, married Yukarin, an android made to look like the Japanese pop star Yuki Kashiwagi, Kotaku reports. The wedding was officiated by another robot named Pepper. She usually spends her days helping customers at SoftBank cell phone stores. The ceremony was even sealed with a kiss. Guests who paid about $80 to attend were treated to a robot sliced cake and a robot wedding band, RT reports. The robot's big day was put on a Japanese company, Meiwaga Denki, which also designated out of his league Froyce. Yukarin was the creation of Japanese artist Takayuki Toto, according to the International Business Times. It is the only matter of time before bots starting to tie the knot. Tech-savvy brides and brooms are ready to employ them as ring bearers and officiants, the New York Times reported last year. It's summer, folks, so you want to hear an obvious sick bleat? Mosquitoes! Who doesn't hate it when those tiny bastards bite your legs? Seriously! Why can't we just make them go extinct? And to add insult to injury, if you live in a rural place with lots of water and trees, you are guaranteed to be bit by swarms. Did I just get bit in the ass by a mosquito? How the f*** did that happen? But anyway, that there is my sick bleat. Ow, sh*t, that hurt. Typhoon Chan-hom is headed for landfall in eastern China within 24 hours and has potential to be the strongest typhoon to make landfall within 200 miles of Shanghai in the last 35 years, according to Jeff Masters of Wonderground.com. As of 5 p.m. local time Friday, Chan-hom Center was about 500 miles southeast of Shanghai, China, moving northwest at 13 miles an hour. Top sustained winds are estimated by the U.S. Joint Typhoon Warning Center at 125 miles an hour. Top sustained winds are estimated by the U.S. Joint Typhoon Warning Center at 125 miles an hour, making Chan-hom a Category 3 storm on the Sapphire-Simpson hurricane wind scale. The CMA raised a red warning typhoon Friday morning for Zhangjiang and Fujian provinces. On its present course, Chan-hom will make landfall in Zhangjiang province near Hangzhou Bay Saturday. Zhangjiang Civil Affairs Bureau said that 60,000 people were evacuated from coastal areas. The country's railway service said that more than 100 trains between the region's cities are canceled through Sunday. Chan-hom may weaken prior to landfall, but its large wind field, typhoon hurricane force, winds extend up to 85 miles from the center. And now time for the Patriot Banners Flying from Nick's Sports Corner. On July 5th, the United States women's soccer team has won 5-2 against Japan in the FIFA Women's World Cup at BC Place Stadium in Vancouver, Canada, officially ending their 16-year drought. America was the quickest of the ball from the opening whistle and immediately reaped greater rewards than they could have ever imagined. A low-driven Megan Rapinoe, corner from the right, deceived a flat-footed Japan defense, and Lloyd finished first time from the near the penalty shot to put a perfect flourish, a training ground move. A low free kick from Lauren Holiday evaded a swath of players before the ball found its way almost magnetically to Lloyd, who applied the finishing touch from close range. The USA were up 2-0 up inside 5 minutes, and Lloyd had nabbed the two fastest goals in Women's World Cup final history. Japan were looking uncharacteristically shaky at the back when their central defender, Azusa Iwashimizu, failed to deal with the Tobin Heath delivery. Holiday latched onto the loose ball to volley home. Only 14 minutes had elapsed, but the USA had already one hand on the trophy. Just 2 minutes later, after the contest was effectively over, as Lloyd completed a 13-minute hat-trick from the goal straight from the realms of fantasy. Collecting the ball inside her own half, Lloyd advanced before unleashing a high shot from the highway line over the head of Ayumi Kayori, whose desperate backpedaling only resulted in finger-tipping the ball onto the inside of the post and into the net. The highlights are a mouthful for me to summarize, but the game was definitely in the hands of our fine women. Congratulations! This is a very important article because it's something that has actually affected my childhood. Back in the day, the arrival of a new Tony Hawk's Pro Skater video game would be celebrated by much fanfare by Activision. Past E3 shows giant halfpipes with skateboarders performing tricks in front of attendees on regular schedule. But a lot has changed at Activision in recent years. These days, the company only focuses on Call of Duty, Skylanders, Guitar Hero, and Destiny at the E3 booth. Even though Tony Hawk is back with his first full-on Pro Skater sequel in 13 years, he has relegated the Quiet Concourse Hall, where Activision also showed Transformers Devastation and Sierra's King's Quest in the small meeting rooms. But Hawk is just happy to be back in the video game business. He's working with the developer Robomoto on the new game, which is coming to PlayStation 4, PlayStation 3, Xbox One, and Xbox 360 this fall. The game rekindles the signature style of the classic Pro Skater games in a brand new set of levels with a focus on daring objectives and fine-tuned controls, including manuals and reverts, for endless shredding and high-score tricks. The next-gen versions introduce exclusive online multiplayer gameplay for up to 20 players at one time.
Well, that's all the time we have on the show. So listen next time on the Nick Dylann Show.